We are live, baby. What is up? Another day, another story here on Jigsaw's Judgment. Let me get these shares going so we can get this show rolling, because we're going to talk about the Eagles today, and we're going to talk about the infamous Sidney Jones. Let me tell you something, fellas. Sidney Jones was not my favorite draft pick. And now he's proving exactly why I feel like he wasn't my favorite draft pick. Right? I think we can all understand why. Right? Give me one second here so I can get this going. How's everybody doing today? Everybody doing good? Everybody safe? Everybody healthy? That's the main thing, right? We're all safe and healthy in this unprecedented time. Let me get these shares going. So while I'm sitting here sharing all this content, let me know, man. Tell me what you guys think. What do you think about the Sidney Jones situation? Because that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about Sidney Jones. We're going to take about 2 minutes. Then we're going to touch on why we feel Sidney Jones is a bust. Do you think I'm crazy? Do you think I'm wrong? I want everybody to let me know. The 2017 draft was just a absolute train wreck, right? An absolute train wreck. It really was. I don't even know what else to say about it, right? Absolute train wreck. We're going to get into that, and we're going to get into that really fast. We're going to start off this Tuesday. Is it Tuesday or Wednesday? I'm like a day behind, man. I don't even know what the days are anymore. I really don't. But we're going to start off this Wednesday talking some Eagles. All right, listen. Here's my deal right now. What's up, everybody? Tony Cutillo, Fox Sports The Gambler, Heat Ratio Sports, PhillyInfluencer.com. Brought to you by Rise and React Media and Prime Roofing for all your roofing needs. So hear me out right now. This is a very interesting situation that we have brewing when we talk about the Philadelphia Eagles. And the reason why it's a very interesting situation is because, lo and behold, we have Sidney Jones talking about being on the hot seat, talking about who knows if Sid's even going to make this team. Now, in 2017, we were told we were so good. The Eagles were so good, we could waste a second-round draft pick on a cornerback with a blown Achilles, who was going to be instantly put on the IR for the entire year. He was going to be redshirted for the entire year. That's what we were told. We were that good. We were that good that we were going to draft Derek Barnett, who to me has not been a first round pick. We were going to draft Sidney Jones, who we figure, you know what? We can wait. Let me just talk to you about some names, okay, that we passed on instead of Sidney Jones. We talk about Owusie from the Cowboys. We talk about Juju Smith-Schuster. How would he look right now on this team? Alvin Kamara. I get we have Miles Sanders, but Alvin Kamara, Cooper Kupp, Chris Godwin, Kenny Galladay. These are all guys that could have been drafted instead of Sidney Jones. And I want to say something, and I'm not going to get on here, and I'm not that guy to come on and say, hey, listen, I told you so, this and that, kind of slap my hand on the back and get an air high five because we are in COVID right now and go through the whole scenario. But what I will say is one thing. One thing is, when he was instantly drafted, I, along with a lot of people in Eagle Land, were not happy. And I hope that those people now that argued with me and said, you're crazy. I don't have a problem with it. This guy's a first-round talent. You know, Howie Roseman isn't supreme in picking talent. Okay, so Howie Roseman should be on the hot seat for that draft. Okay, you say what you want, but Howie Roseman needs to look himself in the mirror when it comes to who he drafted between, listen, Derek Barnett, then you have Sidney Jones, then you have Rasul Douglas. So you drafted two guys in Sidney Jones and Rasul Douglas who can't play. I like Rasul Douglas, but in this system, they don't like him. He's not playing. Sidney Jones is probably going to get cut. Sidney Jones. So for 3 years, we sat on a second-round pick who we had no idea could play or not. We sat on him. And now it looks like he is eventually going to be out the door. That is labeled a bust, my friends. That is labeled a bust. Sidney Jones is a bust. And you know what? Here's what kills me about Sidney. Okay, great. He got on the field a couple times last year and made a couple plays down the stretch. Congratulations. But I need consistency. I need you to show up. I need you to not run away from tacklers. I need you to show up right now each day, you know, every day, and be the top corner on this team. Because besides Darius Slay, this is what you were supposed to do. That's why we drafted you. That's why, you know, we drafted him and Rasul Douglas, so we wouldn't be sitting here listening to Jim Schwartz say, I don't know about Sidney Jones. I'm not sure about the secondary. I'm not sure about, we're going to have a positionless secondary. This is what Jim Schwartz said, a positionless secondary. Never heard of such a thing. Never heard. So we're going to have a bunch of guys running around making plays. Great. But if they don't know what their position is, how does that even work? I don't know. I think it's a very strange statement. Everybody, it's a copycat league. That's what kills me. So they look around and they see what other teams are doing and they figure, you know what? This is what I want to do. This is what we're going to do. And guess what? I don't agree with it. I don't, I've said this, I've been on record, and I'll say it again. The defense of this team concerns me. It absolutely concerns me, not because of injury, because of lack of ability and lack of talent. You listen, I don't care if Nigel Bradham got cut by the New Orleans Saints. All I'm saying is you took out Nigel Bradham and Malcolm Jenkins, two guys who were your quarterbacks on the defense, and you did not replace them whatsoever. You did nothing to replace them. Absolutely nothing. You expect Rodney McLeod to step into a position and automatically assume the role of the lead defensive back calling the shots. You expect guys like TJ Edwards to step in and be the linebacker you need instead of Nigel Bradham to be able to call the defensive line shots. What are you thinking here? So you think because you sign the cornerback, the nickel corner out of, from the Rams, right? And Robert and Robert Smith, and then you're talking about you sign a guy from the Denver Broncos who has Philly ties. I get it. And Will Parks, you think everything's going to be okay? Listen, there's a lot of question marks. Thank God they traded for Darius Slay. But I'll tell you what, after Darius Slay, there are nothing but question marks in the secondary. And now to hear that our former first-round pick, who was supposed to be a superstar, well, guess what? I don't think he's done anything more than Markelle Fultz, and they've come from the same area, right? They come from the same school. So this is almost like our Markelle Fultz, if you think about it, which is crazy, absolutely crazy. Mike, what's up, Mike? Checking in. Never should have let Malcolm go. Right. I don't care how old Malcolm Jenkins was. It doesn't matter. He was, not only was he the spiritual leader, not only was he the veteran leader, but he was the quarterback on defense, right? But, right, I mean, yeah, Sidney Jones was second round. But he's second round, and the reason why I'm labeling him a bust is because, you know, he was a first-round talent. That's what everybody said, first-round talent. That's okay that he blew his Achilles out. He'll be okay. Don't worry about it. We can let him sit for a year. I'm sorry. I mean, listen, Derek Barnett's a nice player. Derek Barnett's not a first-round pick. He's not. Sidney Jones, not a second-round pick. Rasul Douglas, not a third-round pick. So you completely botched that entire draft, especially when you think you have all these issues right now at the wide receiver position. You really do. You're drafting guys like J.J. Arcega-Whiteside who can't get on the field. You know, you're relying on DeSean Jackson, who shows that he can't shut his mouth and he can't stay healthy. If he could, he would be ridiculous in this system. Okay, Alshon Jeffrey, who's stealing money again. And, you know, listen, he had one half-decent year, and after that, we paid him as a top receiver in football. Right. And then Joe Douglas was not it. Mark, you're right. Joe Douglas, you know, we heard about Joe Douglas was supposed to be the end all be all. Right. That's what we heard about. We heard that Joe Douglas was going to be our savior. He comes from Baltimore. And, you know, they've had these great drafts. Well, guess what? Between him and Howie, they both sucked. Absolutely. You know, Mike says reach for a lot of guys. Ton of guys they reach for. Ton of guys. Absolutely. And I don't get the reach. I don't get it. You know, I understand that the NFL draft is not fantasy football, but you also have to have your board. And you need to, you know, I hate to say it, it's like an Andy Reid phenomenon when they say, you know, you take what the board gives you, just like I need to put players in better positions to make plays. But what I have to say, though, is you got to go with your tier system, right? If I'm drafting a team and, you know, the 10th best running back is available as opposed to the fourth best receiver, I have to take that guy, right? Now, I don't know what their board dictated, and I'm sure it probably dictated Sidney Jones being high because he dropped in the draft. But still, you have to look at the history. You have to they were acting like they were the New England Patriots, that they could just afford to take guys to sit on them and wait. That doesn't happen. You have to continue to be good, continue to be competitive, especially when your secondary wasn't that great already, right? It wasn't that great already. So why do they love Pac-12 guys? You know what, Mike? I have no idea. They definitely have a system. I could tell you that. They have a system on their boards. They have a system on, you know, the way Mike, this is what kills me. The wide receivers are going to cross us. You're right. And it had to do with the Cowboys. Think about that. Just think about that statement. The Cowboys wide receivers are going to cross us. You know, you took CeeDee Lamb from us. You had to watch Jerry Jones laughing and giggling, having such a good time, right? Knowing we want it. CeeDee Lamb. And not only do we have to watch CeeDee Lamb, we have to watch him wear number 88, which is Michael Irvin's number. So we have to eat that every single game that we watch, right? You still have Amari Cooper. You have Michael Gallup. For my money, Michael Gallup is the best wide receiver on that team. And I think he's going to prove it this year. So, you know, you have a three-headed monster, and then you have to worry about Zeke. And then you have Blake Jarwin, who can ball at the tight end position. There's a lot of interesting removable parts here for Dallas while we're sitting here thinking, who are we going to throw to? Mike said, Mike, you think Lamb's better than Gallup? Listen, you know, he very well could be. I just think that this year specifically, I know, you know, Lamb probably has the most exceptional raw ability of any of the receivers that were drafted in the class, but without having the time to develop the relationship with Dak and learn the offense and to learn the play callings and to get used to his you know, get used to the coverage and watch the game film because of COVID, I just don't think any rookie receiver is going to have a tremendous kind of year, especially in this unique world that we're living in. Oh, I just wrote it. No, sorry. Oh, my bad. I thought you were writing that in order. But, yeah, listen, I love CeeDee Lamb, though. I'm not – I think, Mike, if you take that order and you wait till next year, 2022, say, 2021, 2022, I think that order will prove to be correct. I do, because I still think Amari Cooper is the third best receiver on this team, which is scary. And I'm not saying Amari Cooper stinks by any means. What I'm saying, he's very inconsistent, and I don't think he's the guy that he's being paid to be. That's why I would have never gave him that money. Michael Gallup is an exceptional talent. Michael Gallup has – the the vertical leap like no other on that team. And he is not afraid to go across the middle. He has ridiculous speed. He reminds me of a guy that played in Atlanta for a lot of years named Roddy White. Roddy White was an exceptional receiver. He was always consistent. You know, he got hurt towards the later stages of his career. So, it killed his stats a little bit. But when he was balling and he was drafted and he played, he was unbelievable for the Atlanta Falcons. So, I just think that that's the kind of player that Michael Gallup is. Mike says we shouldn't be excited for this roster. And we'll see. You know, here's the thing, to talk about the Eagles as a whole, the one thing we could consistently say is we have the quarterback, right? That's what we can always say. We have the quarterback. So that is the biggest deal. We have the quarterback, so we don't need to worry about that. And if you look at the story of franchises year after year who have been competitive, who continue to be competitive, they always have that number one guy behind center. And that's, as long as he can stay healthy, that's Carson Wentz. I think the offensive line should be, as long as Lane Johnson is okay. Okay, if Andre Dillard works out, I really like Jason Peters coming back. Jason Kelsey is just an absolute beast. Just don't know how much more much gas he has left in the tank because he is so explosive and he's undersized as a center, but he's so his athleticism picks up for what he lacks in ability. But he is still one of the best centers in the league. I just don't know how long that's going to last. So, Carson needs to stay healthy. He really does. Lots of weird injuries on the O-line this year. Absolutely. And I think you're going to see a lot of weird injuries the entire year. We're going to get to see how deep this roster is. I hate to say it, but I have no reason believing that Jalen Hurts will play at least one game as a starting quarterback for the Philadelphia Eagles this year. I just think that scenario does play up. I do. I think, you're going to see – you're going to see franchises do a lot of different things this year. A lot of different things. I think players from practice squad, players from the third string are going to play a lot more than in previous years. I think they're going to be, obviously a lot of soft tissue injuries. We're going to see that. A lot of hamstrings, a lot of groins. That's going to be apparent. You're going to see a lot of guys that are going to be suffering from fatigue, right? Because they're not going to be as build up and ready for the season to start. So I think it's going to be a slow build to the NFL. I really do. I think I don't think red zone's going to be going crazy in week one, but I think by week four, it'll catch up because there was no preseason. I sat on the bench and talked with Kelsey and May. He isn't a worry this year. Mike, that's cool, man. How'd you do that? Did you get you sat on what beach was that? That's awesome, man. He looks like a completely normal guy too, like the average, just blue collar kind of guy you see shopping at Acme, picking up some ragu sauce, a couple pounds of lunch meat and some rolls for dinner. That's the kind of guy Jason Kelsey seems to be to me, which I think is why so many people gravitate towards him and his personality, which I think is huge. And listen, the Philadelphia Eagles, make no mistake about it, that's the kind of people they draft, right? He rented a condo above me in Seattle. That's pretty cool, man. That's pretty cool. It sounds like he's a really personable guy. I've been able to see some of his interviews, never interviewed him personally, but he definitely seems like a very personable guy, which is a good thing. This team, I understand a lot of us have Super Bowl aspirations, and, obviously I think you always should, to be honest with you, because you have number 11. But, Miles Sanders, number 11, these guys, I'll tell you what, man, they're the guys going to separate themselves from what happens this year. They really are. Travis Kelce was with them as well. They were awesome. Met with the kids. Travis looks like a nut, man. Travis Kelce looks crazy. I think he might be crazier than Gronk. I really do. I think Gronk gets all the notoriety for being a party animal, but I think I think Travis Kelce is well on his way to surpass the ideologies of the man they call Rob Gronkowski. I would definitely like to see Travis Kelce fight for the 24/7 championship in WWE. That's for sure. But listen, I want to know, you know, everybody tuning in, how do you think this secondary plays out? You know, do you really feel Sidney Jones gets cut? Who is going to start? Is Avante Maddox a starter? Is Jalen Mills a starter? You know, how is this going to play out? You know, where is Will Parse go? You know, is Robert, is he going to be, or, you know, is he going to be the nickel guy? There's so many different scenarios you could play out when you talk about this Philadelphia Eagles secondary. Thanks for bringing the content and energy every day. Oh, you got it, buddy. Listen, man. Mike, I'll tell you what. It's comments like that that keep me going, for real. You know, I've been working on this for about 6 months to be able to do this every single day. It's been a long haul. I redid my entire studio, tried to get some really nice background so I wouldn't have to use digital. Wanted to get all the systems set up, the pages in place, get all the right equipment. You know, I didn't want to come on here on a cell phone and just start talking to a screen, you know. And listen, I'm not saying anybody, you know, I'm not begrudging anybody for doing that. Listen, my show is called The Heat Ratio, right? Nick, my man, what's up, Paz? Nice to see you, buddy. Miss you, bro. As always, yo, if anybody needs, listen, anybody listening right now, listens on replay, Nick Paz, check him out at Nick Paz on Twitter. He does all my jingles for my show, all my intros, my outros, has his own band, his son has his own band, starting his own record label one day, makes his own beats. If you need anything when it comes to music or any kind of voiceovers or sound, go check my man Nick out, man. He will not steer you wrong. Mike, the hard worker show and all. Listen, man, I appreciate it. I do. It's something that, you know, it is hard work and it's consistency and it's something that I sat back and I watched for a long time and I figured out, you know, what my direction was going to be, trying to get there, you know, various different platforms. And one thing I will say, and I'm not going to get sentimental here, but one thing I will say that I don't think a lot of people give enough credit for: stop bashing all the people that do podcasts. Stop bashing the people that go live. Okay. Respect the fact that they're taking the time to try to create their craft, right? Respect the fact that they're taking the time to try to bring you content. It may not be great, right? It may not be stellar in the beginning, but I'll tell you what, you know, they're working at it. And if they stay at it and they stay with it, there's a lot of great minds out there in the world of podcasting. There's a lot of great minds out there in the world of Twitter. There's a lot of people that, hey, listen, not everybody can sit in front of a mic all day long and just talk sports. They probably want to, but they also have to make a living as well. So not everybody can do that. So that's one thing I always prided myself on. I never declined an invitation to go on a show. I never declined an invitation to do an interview because a guy had 10 followers or a guy, had 20 shows. Doesn't matter. Everybody's unique in their own special way. So you will not see Jigsaw on here bash another podcaster unless he comes at me first, obviously, but you won't see me do that. I don't do that. I lay claim to everybody and I lay gratitude to everybody as well. So guys, when you're checking in and comments like that, it definitely means the world to me. I really appreciate it. But yeah, listen, Jigsaw's judgment every day, and I'm going to keep trying to bring the heat. The show is called The Heat Ratio for a reason, right? The other day when I was going off about the Sixers, my co-host Mike Mataraki was like, Hey, you're going to have enough left in the tank for the Heat Ratio tonight? I always get enough left in the tank, right? All I need to do, I can tell you right now, I could probably end this feed right now, go on Twitter, find somebody that wrote a comment, find a story, and just start burning up inside and get ready to go off, right? Yo, Mike, yeah. Listen, when this shit is over, let's get a beer, catch a game, eh? Absolutely. I 100% love that. I would love to do that. I'll be honest, there's probably about at least 15 of you guys that listen to this and you follow me from when we started with PI, you cross over to the Gambler. You've always been a Heat Ratio fan, and I would love to do nothing but you know, rent out like an Xfinity Live back room. Let's just watch a game, have a table, buy you guys some beers, and, you know, get to know everybody, because I think we've built a really, really good community here, man. I really do. I'll poke the bear. You want me to start throwing hot takes at you? Stoke the fire. Mike, listen, I'm not a take guy, but what I can tell you, though, is you give me whatever you want, and I'm sure I could play it on words, and I'm sure I could have a rebuttal. And, you know, we could go back and forth all day long, because that's one thing I love to do. I love to back up what I say. And a lot of people just throw stuff up against the wall, and they, you know, they really have no idea. Listen, for simple, I'll give you a simple scenario, right? And, you know, I want to talk Eagles this way, but, you know, the Tyronn Lue thing killed me yesterday. And I seen a lot of comments back and forth about why Tyronn Lue should be the head coach of the Sixers, because he's a champion, because he knows what it takes to win, because he has experience. But my problem is, my simple issue with Tyronn Lue is he's a player's coach, right? And he's a player's coach. He was LeBron's puppet. Scotty Talks Sports, I think his name is, you know, on Twitter, mentioned that the other day, and he was absolutely right. You know, listen, LeBron ruled Tyronn Lue. What do you think Joel Embiid's going to do? And Ben Simmons, if Tyronn Lue is here, do you think they're going to respect Tyronn Lue? No, you need somebody else. That's why I would not take Tyronn Lue. Look at Mike trying to say Neto is the future of the Sixers. Yeah, well, guess what? Neto should be on a bus to Jamaica right now, and we should have Trey Burke on this team. We should have never got rid of him. Trey Burke should have been a guy, and that's another bad decision by Brett Brown, in my opinion. You know, you watch Trey Burke being able to light the fire for Dallas, right? So, again, you know, that was another bad decision. So, if no Lue, who do you think the top two guys are for you? Well, I'm going to defray to one thing. My top guy, I should say, is a female. And I still say my top choice is Becky Hammon. I am a big advocate for Becky Hammon. I'm going to continue to talk about Becky Hammon. I'm going to continue to tell you that I want Becky Hammon on this team as a head coach. I want to break walls. I want to break sound barrier. I want to break every theory and put it to rest. And I want a female head coach in here right now who has been working her ass off to get up to where she was, to bury the stereotypes that women cannot be a head coach in the NBA. She's learned from one of the greatest in Popovich. She's shown to be able to develop players at a young age. She coached the Olympic team. She shows that she can be a disciplinarian and a leader for younger talent. She reborn, you know, DeMar DeRozan is reborn. LaMarcus Aldridge is reborn in San Antonio. Why? Because of Becky Hammon. Read the story. Read what she does. She's not Greg Popovich. She's not Brett Brown. She has her own style. There's a reason why she kept moving up the bench to be the second in command on that team as the number one assistant coach under Greg Popovich. That's who I want, because you know what? Those players on that team, that's going to be a statement that shocks the world. That's going to be a statement that shocks the Sixers when Ben Simmons, Joel Embiid sit there and go, whoa, what is going on here? And the first press conference, when Becky Hammon shuts all the media up and shuts all the fans up and shuts all the prognosticators up and shows that she means business, I'll tell you what, man, we are in. And you know what, Mike? I hear you. Philly fans, you think we'll crush her. We aren't the most PC fans. I completely agree with you. I do. I get it. I'm sure. But you know what? I tell you one thing, and I've said this before, and I'll say it again. In any line of business, if you're a female and you get to the top, there's a reason why you got to the top. You are a killer, okay? You can take the heat. Because guess what? If you have to rise to the top, you know, and we all know what kind of comments that probably come along with you getting to the top, right? The kind of adversity, the kind of obstacles that you have to jump through just to get to that top spot. So I'll tell you what, I am not worried about Becky Hammon being able to take the PC, the PC fans here in Philadelphia and the media. I feel she will crush them and we will not crush her. My second pick is interesting. You know, I still think it's Mark Jackson. I still think Mark Jackson got a raw deal in Golden State. Mark Jackson is still an old school basketball mind, but also is very open to tremendous guard play, which you see all around the NBA. The problem is we need the guards to run the system. That's what we need. He was a very big proponent of getting the ball down low. Okay. He really was. He was a very big proponent, but he was also a very big proponent of getting the ball down low, kicking it back out to his shooters because he was afforded that luxury out there in Golden State. He got a lot of flack in Golden State. You know why? Because he was trying to play an old school tile low post kind of game. He got a lot of flack for that. That's why the players didn't buy in. They also didn't buy in because he was in their business a lot. Because Mark Jackson is an old school guy and he said, listen, man, you're either all in or you're not. And that means get your ass off social media. Get your ass off popping off to the paper. Stop worrying about that and worry about you and the team. You keep everything in-house like we're supposed to be. You perfect your craft and you put it all in, just like the guys did. Mark Jackson, think about the guys that Mark Jackson played with in his career. Think about the players Mark Jackson played with in his career. That will not only help the 76ers, but it will help the younger guys understand what it takes from a guy. Brett Brown didn't play basketball in the sense of, you know, you couldn't turn on the NBA and watch Brett Brown play. You know, you could turn on and watch Mark Jackson. And I think that that's a true testament. And the also thing is, you know, the first replay of Mark Jackson is going to be getting stepped over by Allen Iverson in 2001, which is another reason why I don't want Tyronn Lue. To me, say what you want, but that's a mockery right there. That, you know, and that's something that everybody's going to have a ton of, ton of talk about, right? Everybody's going to be throwing that up, throwing a meme. And I know it's funny, it's cute, but at the end of the day, that's not who I want my NBA basketball coach to be. I'm ready to run through a wall. Listen, man, I'll tell you, I'm telling you right now, Becky Hammon, we need to make it happen. I am going to be utterly disappointed if the decision comes out and it's 100% Tyronn Lue and they don't give anybody else a shot, because I just think that they're selling themselves short again. They really are. And they're destroying this franchise right now. You know, we sat through a hellacious process, right? A historical process, right? Got me fired up with that. Well, Mike, right? Think about it. Think about, you know, and again, and not because it's me saying it, but it all makes sense. It all makes sense. You know, look at the guys, and I know Kevin's out here today. Kevin Jones and Andre aren't checking in yet. They're probably working. Good to them. We'll get them tomorrow. But, you know, when they start talking about saying, Sam Cassell was a killer from the outside, man. He was a beast. So, again, these are Jason Kidd. Jason Kidd is another one. Jason Kidd is another one that I would like to see here. But you're right. I love the hashtag, anyone but Lou. And again, I hope I can get on a one-on-one with my boy Phil Stifel from All About the Birds and a contributor at Heat Ratio Sports, because I know he is a big, big Tyronn Lue guy. I'm working too. Don't tell my balls. That's funny, man. Yeah, your secret's safe with me, Mike. Absolutely. I don't know. Maybe get your boss to sponsor Jigsaw a little bit, and maybe he'll let you watch every day. No, I'm just kidding. Seriously though, at the end of the day, I want to do this video 30 minutes. I went a little over. You know, I got to get ready for my next show at 10:30. It's a Sports Guy Mike show. Check me out. Again, you see the ticker on the bottom, at TCatello23 on Twitter, PhillyInfluencer.com, which is streaming this right now, Fox Sports The Gambler. Again, a different kind of sports talk, a different kind of game. You know, I'm on there every Tuesday, Daily Ticket with Sean Brace, do a fancy segment every single day. Check that out. Check out the YouTube page, Heat Ratio Sports. If you go to my YouTube page, our YouTube page at Heat Ratio Sports, not only will you be able to see all our episodes, you'll also be see all the Jigsaw judgments. You'll be able to see all the live events that we do. You'll also be able to see all the podcasts that we do, from fantasy sports to just talking about Philly sports. It's all there. Check it out. Subscribe. Give me some comments. Give me a ring. Try to build that up as well. So anything you guys can do, man, would be complete appreciation. Good collaboration that Mike. Listen, Mike Looper, man, Sports Guy Mike, I could definitely tell you, Mike, that he's a tremendous guy, man. He does a lot of work. And he runs a great, great program over there. And it's really nice to be, you know, I'm on the dial, man. Everybody said, I'm on the dial. So it's great. I missed a round table with the PI crew. Listen, I know, Mike, I hear you, brother. The PI lives, they were lit, man. Try to bring them back, but it doesn't always work. I'm trying. At least I'm trying to give you something from PI. I can tell you that. Bill, I haven't talked to Bill in forever. What's up, Bill? How you doing, buddy? We should have hired Mike D'Antoni when we had the chance. Oh, Bill, I don't know, man. I'm not a D'Antoni guy. Listen, I will give you this. If we would have hired Mike D'Antoni, think about what kind of system we would have run on this team. Mike D'Antoni means shooters, doesn't he? We would have been in trouble on this team. Now, if you tell me that we could have Russell Westbrook or CP3, or even give me Eric Gordon, hey, listen, bring Mike D'Antoni. But I just think that to be able to run a Mike D'Antoni system would be a complete issue with the lack of shooters that we have. My man Eric checking it out. What's up, Eric? How you doing, buddy? They blow that cornerback ego by saying he looks great. No, tell him, show him, prove. If not, pack your bags. Listen, man, I don't think Sidney Jones needed somebody to give him an ego. I could tell you that because I could definitely tell you that Sidney Jones definitely had his own ego when he walked into this arena, and he automatically assumed the role that he was going to be Asante Samuel right from the bat, right? And I'll tell you what, man, that was one of the downfalls. That really was. That was one of the downfalls right there. And again, Sidney Jones is a bust. Simple as that. If we're talking about a guy being on the hot seat and we're talking about a guy who may not make the team, a guy who was a former second round pick, could have been a first round pick if he wasn't injured. He's definitely a bust if he can't get on the field. He is what he is. You know that. Yad felt like he was a star. Absolutely. Listen, Sidney came in. He came in with that moxie. Listen, I don't mind if you come in with an attitude. I don't come in, Asante Samuel was one of the most egotistical cornerbacks you will ever watch play the game, next to probably D'Angelo Hall. But I'll tell you what, when you talk about Asante Samuel, he was able to back it up, right? Asante backed it up. He wasn't getting burnt. Asante backed it up. So Sidney Jones, you have to, like Eric said, you got to prove it. You got to earn those stripes. You got to earn that ego. You can't just because you did something in college, it doesn't matter. This is the pros, man. Things are a lot faster in the pros. Things happen a lot quicker in the pros, right? Eric, Asante talked the talk. Yes, he did, man. I'll tell you what. Asante Samuel, probably one of my favorite players ever to wear a Philadelphia Eagles uniform. Really. I really do. Besides Eric Allen, my favorite corner ever to play. I'm not going to say defensive back because we all know that's B-Dog. But when we talk about the corner position, Eric Allen is my number one. And I think Asante is a really good number two. That'll be a good topic for tomorrow. We talk about Eagles cornerbacks. And I'll put that in your ear tomorrow, fellas, because I'm going to have to get out of here, get ready for my next show. Put that in your ear for tomorrow, because we got two topics on tomorrow. Actually, tomorrow, Jigsaw's Judgment, why I will not pay Zach Ertz. So put that in your ear right now. I do not want to pay Zach Ertz. I know I'm going to get a lot of flack for that, but I will be back here tomorrow, 9 a.m. Jigsaw's Judgment. Check me out. Get ready for the Zach Ertz talk, and then we'll talk some Philadelphia Eagles cornerbacks the following day. I appreciate everybody checking in. Again, check me out at Fox Sports The Gambler, at Heat Ratio Sports, at PhillyInfluencer.com, and at TCutillo23. All right, everybody, stay safe, stay healthy, and we will catch you tomorrow.